It is an absolute honor on a Saturday morning to have two prosthodontists show up at my house. Thank you so much for coming over today.
Thank you.
This is going to be an exciting podcast. So right over here, we have Nate Farley. You might have known as the older brother, Chris Farley. And how was he your older brother or was he was your older brother? My favorite Chris Farley.
I wish.
My favorite Chris Farley was, does this shirt make me look fat?
Right.
No, your face makes you look fat. God, I love Chris Farley. Nate Farley is an outright nerd who found his passion in dentistry. He practices as a prosthodontist at Gundersen Health Systems in Southwestern Wisconsin. He is originally from Northern California, completed his undergraduate degree at BYU before heading east to attend dental school at the Ohio State University. If you don't say the, they know you don't know what you're talking about. And stayed at OSU for his prosthodontic residency. There he earned a master's of science with his thesis challenging the accuracy of CAD/CAM surgical guides against traditional guides used for implant placement. A couple of years into practice, he received board certification in prosthodontics. As a true nerd, he loves to push the boundaries of digital dentistry through use of intraoral scanning, 3D modeling, virtual wax up and implant planning, and in-office 3D printing. He taught himself web development while in his undergrad, creating an online forum for his dental class to discuss concepts and shares files, co-created dentaltunes.com in dental school, co-created whatimplantisthat.com in his residency, and continues to build online dental resources through Infodontics LLC, which he co-founded with Kent Howell. Outside work, Dr. Farley loves to hike, ride bikes, and build Legos with his wife and three kids. Now, Kent Howell over here is also a prosthodontist. He who maintains a specialty practice limited to prosthodontics in Mesa, Arizona. Dr. Howell attended Case School of Dental Medicine in Cleveland, Ohio, and then completed a three-year prosthodontic residency at The Ohio State University. During his residency, he earned an MS degree in the study of dental implants, where his thesis challenged the accuracy of a new CAD/CAM technology called the ENCODE system from Biomet 3i. He is also the co-founder of Infodontics LLC and co-creator of whatimplantisthat.com. whatimplantisthat.com is a free online resource to aid in the identification of dental implants all over the world. There are over 900 implants found on the site, and it has been available online since 2010. It was the inspiration for the first mobile app for dental implant identification in the world, created and launched in 2013. Dr. Howell loves to play golf, restore smiles, and spend time with his family. You guys, man, that is just an amazing bio. Really, I'm so damn proud of you. I've been a fan of What Implant Is That? In fact, if you do a search on Dental Town for What Implant Is That, I mean, it's the answer to so many questions. Anytime anybody posts a question, that's what everybody says, just go to that website.
Right.
So you said there's 900 different implants. How many companies would that be?
We have probably almost 30.
30 companies?
Uh-huh. Majority of those are U.S. Obviously, some of those companies are all over the world, but the majority of those are commonly found in the U.S., which when we're helping others identify implants, we're trying to focus on the U.S. ones. They're a lot easier for us to identify. We found that a lot of these foreign implants that we get sent to us are extremely difficult to figure out what they are because there's no resource. Even for us, we know a lot of folks that we kind of touch base with them to help us identify. And some of these foreign ones, there's just no way to know what they are.
And I think that leads to a certain point where, you know, you can always buy on price and volume mm-hmm. or higher price and value. And it kind of makes you think if someone's getting an implant case done and you're the doctor, just because you can buy an implant online for $99 from Russia or some China or some country, that is that really the right thing to do for a patient? Because what happens if 5, 6, 7 years later something breaks and the next guy has no idea what the hell this even is?
Or if it even exists anymore.
So I want to back all the way up because podcasters are young. I'm probably the oldest guy that's ever been on a podcast. You had the first implant identification. I think I have the Guinness's old record for the oldest person ever on a podcast. So you're probably talking to 20% dental students. So the first question I should ask two prosthodontists is a lot of the kids, one of the biggest decisions they have to make junior, senior school is should I do a residency? Should I specialize? So there's 9 specialties recognized by the American Dental Association. So what would you say to some kid listening to you right now in dental school thinking, should I be a prosthodontist? How would 2 prosthodontists answer that?
Well, obviously we're going to be a little biased in our opinion. I went into prosthodontics because I liked the complexity. I liked the fact that I was going to be working a lot with dental implants and I was going to learn kind of the ins and outs of all those kinds of things. After getting into it, I love it. I just absolutely love prosthodontics. So, I mean, if anybody is showing any interest in that, I say go all in. It's not for everybody. You do a lot of lab work in your residency, and you do some when you're in practice. And if you love that kind of stuff, I mean, do it.
I think the complexity of today's dentistry is obviously very different than it was, 20, 30 years ago. And the problems that we're seeing in our practice and the front lines, if I had not had the background and the techniques that we learn in residency, there's no way I could figure out how to help these people. I am redoing these older implant cases on a weekly basis in my practice. And I think that coming out of school in today's age, you can't get enough information. You can't get enough education. So. Yeah. If it's not a residency, go do, a 1-year program in some kind of advanced
ADD,
dentistry.
GPR,
something like that. Seems like it's becoming more and more common to get surgical training after dental school, which, as a responsible dentist is probably a good thing. But there are a lot of folks out there that maybe are outstepping their bounds and depends on what they do. But I don't think you can get enough education in today's world.
Yep. So the next question, we have 50 forums on Dental Town, and prosthodontics is one of the biggest forums, but it's separated into fixed and removable. What percent of what you're doing is just pure fixed versus pure removable? But how much is really the new hybrid fixed removable? How would you break it down as a percentage?
I mean, I would say if I'm looking at my practice, half of what I do is still going to be a removable. Mostly dentures, not so much partial dentures.
And is that because you're in Wisconsin and eating cheese? A cheese head just doesn't need that much retention?
I don't know.
No comment.
But I would say that for being in such a small town, some would argue and believe that you're not going to find big cases. And you're not going to find the people that want the more expensive fixed cases like the hybrids. And but I do plenty of those too. And so I think I get a wide variety being in such a diverse community. But yeah, I'd say it's a good mix and more, I mean, I if you looked at our numbers, you'd probably see a slow increase in the amount of implants that we're utilizing to fix teeth.
So fix is going up.
Yeah.
Pure removable is going down.
I would say in the realm of partial dentures, I think is going down because of implants. But there's always going to be people that they're...
I guess, what about full dentures though?
We do a lot of full dentures.
So you're still doing a lot of full dentures?
Because there's still going to be people that's just beyond their price point.
Yeah. Same question to you, or can I go to the next question? Let me go to the next question. Some of these fixed cases, I don't agree with the tree implant. You'll see a bunch of implants, and they lost their teeth because they couldn't take care of their teeth. Mm-hmm. And it seems like the fixed removable, where they can pop out that denture, brush it in their hand, it just seems like that's such a... Is that a longer-lasting restoration because it's easier to clean? Or is that something that you just don't sell a lot of because people psychologically don't want it to come out of their mouth?
That's a fantastic question. I think you hit the nail on the head. It just depends on their psyche, I think. There's so many different levels of transitioning from your own dentition to a prosthesis. Even if you only have a couple teeth left, I mean, you've seen that in your practice, I'm sure. But I see so many folks that just cannot grasp the concept of something that is not permanently in their mouth. And so you find a way to provide that for them. There is a way to provide a prosthesis for them that doesn't come out, that they can clean on their own and have a healthy oral cavity for the rest of their life. It takes planning, it takes precision. You have to make sure that it's designed properly. And then you, the follow-up is key, obviously keeping them in the practice and the hygiene and keeping an eye on things. So, and there are a good group of folks that would like to have that denture in their hand and clean it, and so they know they're getting everything. But at the same time, even with their dexterity, that may not be possible for them. There's a lot of folks that say, you know what, I want this, but they just can't take it in and out of their mouth. It's just physically not possible for them.
That's why I went with the wig instead of hair transplants, because I wanted to be able to just, you know, clean my head. Nice. And I couldn't take the transplants out. So now let's go to the next $1 million question is, you know, in America, you know, you got 80% believe it's truth, liberty, and justice the American way, and the other 20% think money's the answer. What's the question? They're trying to decide how to get more training in implants, mm-hmm. but a lot of it's tied to an implant manufacturer. Mm-hmm. So then they're kind of sitting there thinking, okay, you almost have to know what implant you should go with before you do the training, because every time you go take a course, what percent of the instructors in the dental arena in America do you think are hawking a dental implant? Mm. Because they're sitting there thinking, okay, I want to learn more about implants, but you know, obviously there's so many different camps, there's so many different implants. Mm-hmm. So tell them, we're in Phoenix. Do they need to be in LA? Are they headed to LA or New York? They got to know, what implant system would you go with? Because if you gave them three names of implants, then they could start doing training and say, okay, I'm going to buy your system. I've already made that decision, sure. But now teach me implantology.
I mean, when...
But back to the first question. What percent of the speakers do you think are biased towards a commercial company selling implants?
I think the ones that are being funded by those companies are going to go in with a bias. A week ago, was in Boston at Dentsply Sirona at a conference, and I know that they were biased towards that implant system, and they have a good implant system. They're not the only good implant system.
Which is funny, because how many implant systems has Dentsply had in the last 30 years?
Oh, right. Man, man.
Right. So are they biased towards another implant system that'll be RIP soon, or is it?
I think there's a lot of people out there lecturing that are not biased towards a system because they're getting that cut back, you know, and they're just, that's what's worked in their hands. I mean, I think the truth of the matter is there's a lot of implants that work just fine.
Yeah. Well, why don't you tell them the names up, because the names up.
So when we were in our residency at the Ohio State University, they were very proud that they were teaching us a wide variety. And so in school, we worked with Astra, we worked with Nobel, Straumann, Zimmer, and 3i. Mm-hmm. So those were
Astra, Nobel,
Zimmer. 3i, which now Zimmer and 3i have merged. So that's one company now, Zimmer Biomet. Astra was now bought up by Dentsply Sirona.
Straumann.
And then Straumann.
And then Straumann's buying everybody. They bought Megagen out of Korea. Mm-hmm. They bought Neodent out of Brazil.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
They bought the, what did they buy out of Israel?
Is it that one that's like the active?
Yeah, that's kind of, it might be a Neodent.
They bought the largest implant company in Korea, Brazil, mm-hmm. Israel, and about half a dozen other countries.
Wow. Mm-hmm.
But
in my practice, I primarily work with Nobel, 3i, a little bit of Astra.
Nobel and Zimmer. Zimmer's really not a dental implant company. I mean, they're probably 90% medical implants, aren't they? Mostly knees and hips. And
so is Biomet, though. Yeah. I mean, 3i, but it's Biomet 3i. So now it's Zimmer Biomet is the parent company of that one. But so, and that's kind of what attracted those two to each other, I believe. You know, they both had parent companies that were in the orthopedics. And when I did my thesis, I was out in Palm Beach Gardens, Florida, in 3i's headquarters. And when I was chatting with some of the folks there, that's exactly what they told me. It says, you know what? Our dental wing of Biomet is so small compared to what they do around the world in orthopedics that they almost don't even care what we do, you know, I'm paraphrasing. But and so I think that they found a commonality, and so they, you know, they kind of merged the dental together. But I think in today's world, for the most part, depending on what you want to use the implant for, as long as it's one of the main core implants, I don't think you can.
And what was Astra's story before Dentistry bought it?
They were just kind of their own thing.
With other things. They weren't just implants. There was AstraZeneca.
But you put Astra in the same. You think Astra Dentsply is a long term player?
I would say.
And there's more.
I mean, there's more. BioHorizons is a company that I would say is one of those big ones. And I mean, the list of ones that you could probably put a lot of trust in is getting bigger. And I think a lot of my opinion comes down to what you said. One thing that you're wanting to put in people's mouths is a company that's most likely going to be around throughout their life when that needs serviced again, because it's going to need serviced
again. How many implant companies have you seen come and go already?
I don't know.
I mean, there's a lot of flash in the pan.
Mm-hmm. I know it's happened. I know that because, so, you know, with our website, we have this unique perspective where we do have people contacting us, asking us what implant they have. And some of these implants are old, outdated, you know, implants that, as we have our network that we reach out to people who've been in this industry for a long time, we learn that they don't sell parts anymore. There's no longer restorative parts for those. And that's where we start kind of backing up our theory that, you know, you want to go with somebody that's going to at least have enough of them out there. You go with a big company, there's millions of implants out there. Even if that company goes under, somebody's going to see the market and provide restorative parts for it because there's a market for it. But if you get a small company that goes out of business, nobody's going to come around and save those patients that have those in their mouths. And so that's what I, my opinion has gone to, is get with somebody who has that market share, just because there's a big chance that there's always going to be somebody catering to that implant.
That you, you told me that you're fascinated by business models.
I did, yeah.
And that you like business, and I have that lab too. And that is something I never applied. So Ryan's grandpa, he was the first person in his farm family in Kansas to go to college, and he went to Wichita State University. And but anyway, he worked. He was an engineer at a company making side balers that made bales of hay. And it was in business for 30 years, and it was little in Mays, Kansas, and, you know, eventually it got beat out by one of the bigger ones. And so they fired everyone. I mean, there's several hundred people all lost their job, and they're all sad and crying and depressed. And he was the only one that walked home and said, well, who's going to service those customers for 30 years? So he went to the bank and bought their machine shops that were already all bankrupt. He thought about it a long time. And out of the, like, 200 employees, he took, like, the best eight machinist. Yeah. And he said, they need service. And, oh, my God, he had a business that was doing, like, $3 million a year with a 50% profit margin until retirement. I mean, he made more money in the last 10 years of his life than he did in the first. I think he was 55 when he started. So that was a very important concept, that if we dentists place several million of one kind of implant, that implant goes out of business. It's a critical mass tipping point that someone's going to step in and say, we're going to service all this. So let's go to whatimplantisthis.com, the app. First, tell them what it is, and then what have you learned from this, having this business that would apply back to, like, which implant would you use? So talk them through the story. Of what implant is this?
So it's what implant is that? We also own what implant is this. So they'll go to the same place.
Oh, so you do own the other URL. Yeah. It bounces over.
It's a common mistake.
It's a common thing. So, like we said, we started the website when we were in residency. We saw a huge need for the identification of implants. Before the web, you had a few articles written about implant identification from Texas and some other places that we were interested in. And we had a mentor in residency at Ohio State who kind of planted that seed in our mind, said, you know what, why don't you create some kind of resource for dentists? And so that's kind of how it was born. We kind of ran with it. Nate has the web design background, and I kind of was boots on the ground as far as getting things together information-wise. And we just reached out to all implant companies that we could find. Many of them were very gracious in helping us to get this resource off the ground because they saw the benefit of it, and it kind of grew from there. And so at one point we said, you know what, why not make an app, make it more accessible and mobile in today's internet world? And So we created this this app. We had a ton of gracious donors that actually helped us fund the app. A lot were friends and family and mentors and from all over the country. And we created this app. And so it's basically a mirror of the website. You can go and search the app and find your implant.
How much is the app on the phone?
I think it's $10.
$10. Yeah.
So we wanted to keep it reasonable. The website is free, and you can go to the website and you can search it and do what you need to get the information for free. We saw the app as a bonus. You know, a lot of times we use it ourselves. If we have an image on our phone, we like to hold it up to the one on our screen in our operatory, and it kind of really helps to visualize the characteristics of that implant. And so
I've started using the app more than the website, only because my radiographs are digital. And so I've got my radiograph up on the computer. Rather than switching between screens, I can take my phone out and use the app.
So what about they're not sure. There's a button on consult with us. How does that work?
So we have a consult service through the website. If somebody doesn't want to find their own, or they can't, or they're having difficulties, or it's not on there, they can consult with us, and we will identify their implant for them.
It's kind of funny how that started. Is we made the website not intending to be doing this, consults for people. We made the website thinking that they'll use the website and find what they need. But early on, we started getting emails of people sending us images and asking. And early on, we just did it for free. And we did that for a while before we thought, these are increasing a lot.
It pretty much consumed our life at that point. So.
And some of them were taking an hour for us to kind of do some research on and get them back an answer. So eventually we thought, you know, if we want to keep helping people out, we got to start throwing a price tag on it.
Dentists have money. I mean, I used to think the bizarrest thing in the world is when about once a year some dentist would thoroughly piss me off. He'd call me and want to know if I had a toll-free number so he could call me back. It's like, what am I, your bitch? I mean, I'm going to answer your question and you want me to call you back on my own dime? I said, you know, you're such an asshole. Don't ever call me again. And it's like, but it's nice having doctors. I mean, when you're in the B2C world, you get the average income as your patient. Mm-hmm. So in America, that'd be $50,000 for a household, everyone in the house. When you switch over to the B2B world of dentist to dentist, now your average customer makes $175,000.
Sure.
So you don't have to be price sensitive when you're in a B2B dental world.
You're saying we should charge more.
Absolutely. what's the answer how to charge?
Yeah.
If you go to market and you say, this is a dollar, and you sell out all your inventory, what's wrong with your price?
It's too low.
If you go to the market and say, this is $10, and you don't sell any, what's wrong with your price?
Right.
So the equilibrium clearing price is where you, you know, an airplane, I'll give you an example on price. An airplane on Southwest Airlines has 120 seats in a 737. So the first flight is the lowest price, the first seats they sell, because those are the people who have the least amount of money and are buying deals 2 weeks out in advance. But each time you sell a seat, the price keeps going up. And the goal is it goes off with the last seat was just sold. You know, the guy just walked up to the ticket counter. So the first person might have paid $200 for that seat, and the last person might have paid $600. So that's adjusting your price on time versus value. Mm-hmm. Like you'll go to a dental office and they'll say, well, you know, you can't get in for a month. Well, then why are you on 12 PPOs?
Right.
I mean, so I call you up. 30% of America has no insurance. They have cash. Like this morning's class example. Woke up this morning. One of my three cats has a red eye. Immediately call the vet. When can you go down there? 10 o'clock. No one has talked price yet.
Yeah.
So if we get there and the guy's, you know, but if he would have said, well, I don't have any openings today. Well, this guy would have just showed up with a Visa card and wants his cat seen. Mm-hmm. So dentists are very bizarre that way where, you know, you won't be able to get in for a cleaning for a month and they're taking 12 PPO plans. Right. It's like, so then that's actually disrespectful to people who value it, who say, I really want to get my teeth cleaned this Saturday. I'm sorry, we haven't even talked price. You might have paid $125 for a cleaning, but we're so busy charging $60 for a cleaning on a PPO that you have to wait in line for a month. And that is not a That's not fair. And also, when I started lecturing in 1990, it was routine that flights and hotels were sold out because there was no computers. And you get to a hotel and it's sold out. Now, flights and hotels are never sold out because they keep bidding up the price of the room. So as a hotel starts running out of capacity, those rooms start doubling and tripling in prices. And I could walk up to any airport in America the last minute, buy a flight anywhere, get to the fanciest, schmanciest, danciest hotel and get a room. It might be 1,000 for the flight and 1,000 for the room,
right?
But they certainly understand price elasticity. Sure. So yeah, so if you go to market with something and you run out of inventory, so what have you learned? What have two prosthodontists learned from owning whatimplantisthat.com? Back to you.
I mean, one thing I've learned is that the implant situation is getting worse, if you will, meaning there's always new implants joining the market, and we're now at a point where there's hundreds of people trying to make implants, there's thousands of implants out there, and people move around a lot. And I think that's, with time, that just is increasing. So
what do you mean people move around? The dentists or the patients?
Both. Okay. But I was specifically talking about patients, where we get a lot of people from the States asking us about what implant is this? Oh, and it was placed in Europe. You know, we're seeing a lot of that. And so when you see that, you just, it kind of goes back to
the
conversation.
So you're saying build that wall. Just to keep patients.
Just to make patience. It easier on us. But no, I mean, and going back to what we just said, is with this expanse of everything that's happening, it's just going to get more challenging for all of us to know how to restore that implant that came in the door and how to get the right parts and pieces. And I mean, it's a skill everybody starts to pick up, and we'd love for them to use our website to be able to bridge that gap in knowledge. But, you know, right now somebody might listen to the podcast and say, well, I've never seen an implant that I wasn't able to know what it is, because maybe everybody in that town is getting Nobel implants. But in time, I think everybody's going to start seeing a lot more of this, where somebody walks in with something that is different than what they've seen, and maybe even something foreign.
One of the trickiest things that we find in consults, and even frankly in practice sometimes, is that there are many, many implants that look very similar to each other, and they have clones, if you want to call it that, and the designs are very similar. We all know that there's, you know, entities out there that make implants very similar to other implants, and so...
Are you talking about Implants Direct or Implants Direct?
all of the above.
Because Nick, that was his business model.
Sure, wasn't it, to make absolutely, yeah. And although the premise of that, I totally get it, and quite frankly, implant dentistry arguably needs to be more cost-effective for the average American, no question about it. And that can apply to getting them care. But on the back end of that, can be extremely difficult. And so you have this war going on where you have third-party components being manufactured that the parent company, let's say Nobel, Straumann, Zimmer, whatever the case may be, they don't want other people making parts for their implants, right? And they don't want other companies to say, well, ours is the same connection as a Zimmer tapered screw vent, internal hex or trilobe or whatever the case may be. But you have all these companies trying to jockey for the same space in the internet world. And so from a restoring dentist standpoint, you look at that implant and you say, okay, it looks exactly like such and such, but I'm not exactly sure that's what it is. It could be this, it could be that. Well, where do I get components from? Well, you can get them from this place, that place, or the actual implant company itself. Well, which is better? You could argue that all day long. You know, these are machine components. Are they really that different? Are they exactly the same? We don't really know.
But on what implant is that? .com, did I get it right?
Yep.
On whatimplantisthat.com, these people are trying to restore an implant. I mean, the implant's successful. It's working, right?
Mm-hmm.
So your average customer has an implant that's osseointegrated. It's working.
Correct.
So I would think there'd be a lot of valuable marketing information in this. I mean, you could go to an implant company and say, mm-hmm. you know, we have a lot of, you know, these are the implants that last the longest. So I think you'd learn a lot on what is working. So I guess the flip side of that is when implants fail, why are they failing? Are they snapping? Is it mechanical failure? Is it peri-implantitis? Why do implants fail?
I mean, I know that we tend to get our biases. There's two camps out there. There's one that likes to cement crowns on abutments, and there's one that like to do the screw retention for their implant crowns. And if you cement and that cement gets away from you, and there's been research. I was just on the plane on the way here looking at a paper that was a few years old, but not, it's pretty relevant. Somebody who did cement retention, then drilled a hole, took the crown off after he thought he had removed everything. And this is a prosthodontist who claims he was being picky and was still finding cement, not only attached to the abutment, but down in the gingiva. And
But cementing is, it's faster, easier, and sloppy.
Yeah.
Because to get a screw retained, that thing's got to fit perfect to line up the screw.
Right.
So it's would you say it's a lot higher skill set to do a screw retaining crown?
It's than different. To cement? It's different. It.
What, you don't have to be as good and accurate for a cement.
I don't know. You could argue that both ways. I think.
Really? So you wouldn't buy that.
I would say yes to your answer. I would say it's easier to cement, but I mean the model that I'm kind of toying around with going, because I see that I've been a screw retained person from my training on. And the things that I struggle most with is I got to take this piece and screw it into place, which put pressure on the gingiva, uncomfortable for the patient, just to check the contacts. And I got to take it in and out every time the patient's, you know, flinching a little bit because of that pressure on the gums. The model I'm thinking about going towards is, well, let me get custom abutment, get a crown that has a hole in it right above the screw access hole, put the abutment in, do all my adjustments, cement it on, unscrew it because there's a hole, clean everything up, then put it back in. So I've only put it in twice. But I get all the same benefits of trying, you know, adjusting contacts, occlusion, all that is just like a regular crown and bridge.
You guys should do an online CE course on this. We put up 360 online CE courses. They've been viewed 600,000 times.
Wow.
So you could work your what's implant is that.
Sure.
You know, so all of our courses, every one of them is ADA approved and AGD approved for credit hours. And that'd be very informative lessons from two prosthodontists.
Yeah.
or you could do two separate ones. And by the way, also on a referral business, one of the biggest feedbacks I've got on these online CE is that these dentists made them because they had so much free time on their hand, which you guys don't.
Mm-hmm.
But it exploded their local referral business. There's a 250,000 dentists on Dental Town. And there were all these dentists in their backyard that they didn't even know who were counties.
Yeah.
And then watched your course for an hour and then calls you up and now they like met you online. Like,
sure. Hey. Sure.
And it's kind of like we're from the same frat or something.
Right.
Yeah.
But a lot of specialists just wanted to do a course, but they said looking back, it exploded their guest invitational lecture. There was one endodontist who put up a course and got booked 76 speaking engagements.
Oh my gosh.
Because what happens is there's 275 places that have dental meetings in America.
Okay.
And it's all volunteers. So
and you've been to all of them. I was.
Oh, I've lectured 1,000 times in America. That's impressive. The kids say, "Have you ever been there before?" Yeah. But they'll say, okay, we need a volunteer for our speaker at the next meeting, and you two get assigned. And they'll say, give us someone from endo, pediatric dentistry, and practice management. And don't get anybody we had last year. Get someone fresh. So you go to Dental Town, all those courses are an hour. So you go to, like, the pediatric dentistry. Well, there's only 6 one-hour lectures.
Uh-huh.
So you just – it's kind of like their demo tape in Hollywood.
Right.
So you listen to six guys say, I really like this Josh Wren guy. Well, let's have him. And then what do we need? We need someone from Perio. Okay, well, there's only like six guys that have a lecture on Perio, and they're only 1 hour each. So it really is your Hollywood demo tape for guest lecturing and referrals. But what I like about it the most, and why I always mention it on my podcast show, is I really don't get that motivated trying to make rich dentists in America and Canada and Australia and New Zealand a little bit better.
Yeah.
That's cool. but it's not my mojo.
Right.
What my mojo is when I break down and cry is when I'm in Africa and Asia and you walk into a dental school and the only curriculum they have is Dental Town. And I make all that stuff free in those third world countries. And that's awesome. I mean, like I was in Kathmandu, Nepal, and there was one dental school. It was donated by a Muslim church out of Pakistan. Uh-huh. And when they built the school, they gave them all their books were 20-year-old Mandarin Chinese dental textbooks and 25-year-old French books, and no one there spoke Mandarin. They all spoke Nepalese.
Right.
Wow. And then the dean, through a Google search, whatever, discovered Dental Town. Huh. And, you know, and I've had this, and when I walk in there, she just started crying. She says, it's our only education. I mean, they got 350 courses by the elitist Americans in the world.
Okay.
And then you got 4 million, you got a 250,000 dentists who have posted 4 million times. And yeah. Like I was in Poland and I met this little girl, Iwa. And her job was the instructors during the day would tell her what threads they wanted. And then at night, she would translate them to Polish.
Oh, wow.
And that was their text because their Polish textbooks are 15, 20 years old. And here you got these Americans talking about this case last week.
Right.
And so they want to translate, you know, so I think that the business model of the textbook has got to be going down the drain.
Agreed.
Because if it takes you 5 years to write a book and then your mm-hmm. business model, you got to sell it for 10 years.
Yeah.
That poor bastard reading at the end's reading 15-year-old information. So back to what implant is that? Do you kind of, can you kind of tell which ones are lasting the longest where young dentists are saying, what implant is that? And you're like, yeah, that's been there 15 years. We find that all the time. Do you have data that sits there and says, because it sounds like you're finding the implants that lasted.
We've seen the whole array. Mm-hmm. One of the questions on our consult form is, you know, when was this implant placed approximately? So we kind of get a feel for that. But a good chunk of what we see in the consults are old calcitech cylinders, stereos, external hex before it was Nobel, all these types of things where it's not the mainstream. You know, a guy doesn't, guy or gal look at the x-ray and say, I'm not exactly sure what that is, and don't even realize that it's still serviced by Nobel because Nobel owns it. So that's where we...
Nobel owns stereos?
Correct, yeah. Nobel purchased stereos, I don't know what the year was, a long time ago.
I can still remember buying my stereos system.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. I think it was 30 years ago. I'm a diplomat at the International Congress of Implantology, Fellowship of the Mission Institute. I bet I bought 5 systems over the years.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And so, I mean, you know better than anybody, then everyone has their own unique components. And I tell my patients that unfortunately, implants are a lot like cars. They have their own parts and pieces. And if you don't use the right parts and pieces, you're not going to keep the warranty. You're not going to keep the longevity of that implant. So surprisingly, a lot of these design and a factor of longevity of an implant, they've gotten infinitely better because of the surface design, connection, all those types of things. So even these old school implants have lasted a really long time, which gives us great hope for the ones of today. We've seen designs improve drastically, even just since we were in residency 5-7 years ago. So,
some people say, Carl Misch is saying it the most, that every cement sold in America and around the world that's for dental implant restoration is toxic and should not be used to cement a dental implant.
Okay.
But he was saying that that's why he was going back to zinc phosphate cement.
Hmm.
And he thought that was the, he said that every single resin cement that says for dental implants is toxic and should not be used under any type of criteria.
Hmm.
So he goes all the way back to the stuff that, all right. Shit, there's dentists that are 100 years old.
Mm-hmm.
By the way, you're never supposed to talk about religion, sex, politics, or violence, but it made me remember a story because this dentist, her last dentist worked till he was 92. But anyway, I saw her at 88, and the election came up. And this is so funny. You would not believe what she said to me. I said, so are you a Democrat or Republican? She goes, oh, it doesn't matter. I'm not going to say who everybody was. And she goes, I just wish I was younger because I was always a precinct committeeman and going all the way back. And she was talking about the first election she worked on. It's like, I didn't even remember who the hell she was talking about. And but she says, yeah, We were so faithful. We'd go to every cemetery in the county, writing in everybody's names. We surround up thousands of votes. We had every cemetery name in the entire county of St. Joe, Missouri. You know, and she was talking about, and this is back in the 20s. And I said, really? You used to drive around and vote for dead people? She said, hell yeah. I'm like, so when you hear people talk about voter fraud, okay, I'm talking to an 88-year-old lady who's bragging about her voter fraud for decades and decades, and wishes she was young enough and healthy enough to continue to do voter fraud. I thought that was so hilarious. I love these things. Wow. So I want to ask you some extremely controversial questions on Dental Town. Where one of them is, you can't make this up. So we have on Dental Town, one of the sections is prosthodontics, and it's fixed prosthodontics, fixed prosthodontic cases, prosthodontic residency, and removal prost. And then another section is implants. Mm-hmm. And we had to separate the mini implants from the implant guys. Because anytime a mini implant would post a case, people would just jump on there like, you're a flipping idiot. And so we had to do the same with CERAC and E4D. Because every time someone would post an E4D case, you know, all the paid spokesmen for Serona... you know, who now they're all, you know, I want to watch the block move the most because they were all for Williams Ivoclair blocks. Uh-huh. But now that they got bought by Dentsply, guess which block they'll all start hawking first thing in the morning.
Right.
Am I right?
Yeah.
100% of them. Yeah. So you kids got to listen saying, okay, why did you recommend, Serona, not E4D? And you recommended Serona with an Ivoclair block. Uh-huh. And then the minute their company merges with Dentsply, now they only recommend a Dentsply block.
Right.
So they're bad-mouthing you on the E4D. I mean, come on. So we had to separate them. So the question is, some people are saying the argument now that 3M, they sold off or closed down their mini implant. What was that, ImTech?
Yeah.
So the question is, because you mentioned earlier that you understood the models of Implant Direct's knockoffs because you realize that price is an issue in a big country. Mm-hmm. Some people say, look, she's grandma. She don't have a lot of money. I'm gonna place some minis. Right. So what's your thoughts on mini implants? Does it serve the poor or is there just no reason for their existence?
That's a great question. And obviously I have some bias and I've seen the whole gamut. I've seen the whole gamut personally.
On Mesa. Yeah. I mean, Mesa. No offense to Mesa, but Mesa, where he practices, let me tell you about Mesa. It's got everything. It's got million-dollar homes. It's got middle-class homes. It's got trailer parks. It's got high-end dentists. It's got Denture World. Mm-hmm. I mean, that could easily be a country.
It's a melting pot for people. And
you see everything, don't you?
I've seen everything. I've seen people from everywhere all over the country. I've seen it all. And so I have a bias, and our training would have a bias also. However, I guess my official stance would be mini implants at one time were designed for a specific purpose. And they can serve that purpose well if kept in those parameters. And I've seen just about every situation where they are not in the parameters that they were supposed to be in. And it's sad because...
But speak more clear, though. So you're saying it was designed for certain parameters. What exactly was that?
Well,
overdentures in a compromised ridge.
Okay, so more detail.
In the mandible. Mandible has typically more dense bone where a mini implant could be more successful, and that's typically where you would find it to be used for that purpose in a removable situation. Where you get in the weeds a little bit is in the maxilla, and you'll have people argue all day long, well, I put them in the maxilla and they work just fine, and that may be very true. But typically, they're not as successful in the maxilla as the mandible.
Okay, so if it was grandma on the mandible, here's my here's one argument. Well, why would you put four minis down there and have grandma snap it over? Because for the price of four minis, you could have put two root forms. Because a lot of people are saying there are rumors. We don't know why. Do you know why 3M?
I don't know. No.
Some people have rumored that, you know, 3M's, you know, they've been around 100 years. They start off as Minnesota Mining and Manufacturing. They no longer do mining or manufacturing.
I didn't know that's what 3M stood for.
Yeah, Minnesota Mining and Manufacturing, and they don't have any mines left, and they're going to be there 100 years. And a lot of people were saying that at 6 to 7 years, anything under 3.0 is breaking. and they wanted they didn't want to own a medical device where metal fatigue snapping.
Sure.
Of course, you know, I can't get that officially from them. But do you think for the price of four minis, you just should have gone to two greater than three? Is your definition of a mini under 3.0?
I'm glad you brought that up. I was just about to say that today's term mini is completely different than the term mini 10 years ago, right? I mean, there's so many different tech designs, and now we have narrow diameter. That's probably the politically correct term, narrow diameter implant, possibly, that have different connections than they used to 5-10 years ago. And now we have narrow diameter implants that are more than just one piece. And so, you know, it depends on what you're using it for. I've seen a lot of cases where we've actually stabilized a denture during healing with mini implants, but from the get-go, we knew that they were a temporary solution for them, but they've worked very well in that solution. Relatively easy to remove, you don't damage bone, et cetera, et cetera. So, it has its purpose in the toolbox, in my opinion, but it's not my go-to. And I would personally prefer to, quote-unquote regular-sized implants in a ridge if we can do that. If that's not a possibility and their life is going to be better with some anchorage on their denture with a mini implant, then there's nothing wrong with that, assuming that it's in the parameters that it's meant for.
I mean, one thing you give up when you go with these mini implants on most systems is the ability down the road to repurpose that implant for a different reason. I mean, most mini implants, you have your attachment and the implant part all as one. That person can't start off with an overdenture, decide that's not for them and want something fixed, and very easily just transition into something fixed.
See, I'm so old, I go with the word mini because I still think of mini pearl in there, or hat with the price tag in. Are you guys, you guys remember watching that with your grandma?
I'm not sure I watched it, but I know what you're talking about.
So back in Nashville, Opryland, USA, what was that country show? The Grand Ole Opry.
Okay, yeah. I thought you were going to say Hee Haw.
And Minnie, same there. And yeah. Minnie Pearl was a lady who always had the hat on, but she left the price tag on. So I want to ask you the next most controversial thing. And what's funny about that is you actually did your master's of science thesis. Yeah. Gosh, on Dental Town, the minute you say surgical guide, my God, you might as well just throw a hand grenade and leave the room. You're going to have all these dentists that say, dude, I've placed 1,000 to 10,000 implants and I never used one. I mean, you got a tooth here, you're a real surgeon, right. Flap that thing back, and if you can't do that, you shouldn't even be a dentist.
Right.
Then other ones like, oh no, you need to have a surgical guide. Then some people say, well, hell, the surgical guide doesn't even fit half the time.
Yeah.
I mean, it's just, of all the columns I ever wrote, I've written a monthly column since 1994. And I think the only one that I ever wrote that had like 500 comments on the message board, and half of them were saying I should be, you know, have my license taken away, was on surgical guides. So wade into that mess. So, and why did you pick your thesis?
I have some opinions.
Why did you pick your thesis on the craziest part of all of implants?
So one thing I'll point out is, as I put in my bio, I'm a nerd. I'm a techie. I like doing stuff like this. When I was in my residency, I wanted to research this because I wanted to prove that you can have better accuracy if you use a CAD-CAM surgical guide versus just a traditional guide, okay? And what my research showed is technically it's a little bit more accurate, but not a lot more accurate, okay? So going to what you said, you get somebody out there who has placed thousands of implants. They probably screwed up along the way, but they've learned some things, so they know a lot more than the guy who's fresh out of school on how to do it right, how to get the implant buccolingually, mesiodistally, and also the right depth. They know those things. I mean, it's ingrained in them. They are most likely going to place that implant in a great place that is going to be restoratively driven, even if the restorative part of it is in their mind knowing what's coming. I still, in my practice, every implant patient that I have, I do CAD-CAM surgery. I don't do the surgery. I make the guide so that the surgeon can put it where I want the implants. I love it. I love it because when it's time for me to restore it, those screw access holes, because I'm a screw retain guy, the screw access holes are exactly where I want them with a very acceptable margin of error. And so for me, it's perfect. But I'm, you know, I'm kind of, you know, a prosthodontist or picky and anal, and I'm an anal prosthodontist is what I always say. So to me, it's what I want. Does it have to happen that way? I don't think so. But what I would argue is if you feel you don't need a guide, don't go screw it up any, because there, as a restorative person, one of the most challenging things that we do is restoring implants that were not placed properly. And while you might...
You mean when the oral surgeon placed them, not the periodontist? Did I say that right? Is that what you just said?
Well, that's a whole different controversy. But when implants aren't placed well, and they're integrated in somebody's jaw, and you can't restore it properly because it was placed poorly, that's a problem. And that's not necessarily because you didn't or did use a guide. It all comes down to, did you treatment plan the case properly? Did you execute things properly? And you could do that a variety of ways.
What percent of those can you fix or get to work?
Well, that's probably a relative term.
It's relative.
Work, right?
Yeah, because you can get them to work, but either one, it's costing the patient more. Two, it's affecting things like hygiene, aesthetics. And so you can often, and sometimes you can't. Sometimes we say, you know what? Let's take the implant out, put a new one in. And often the ones that really push you to those limits is space. You know, somebody wants to do a full arch prosthesis on, it could be an overdenture, it can be a hybrid, it could be a full set of implant-supported bridges. I mean, if you don't have proper space, you're going to fail. And somebody, even the best of the best, is going to struggle to make that person something that is both aesthetic and hygienic and strong enough to last a decent amount of time.
It's probably one of the most common things that we see is inadequate inner arch space design for whatever the prosthesis may be. Most commonly, surprisingly, it's removable overdentures on locators. That's probably the most common thing on the maxilla. That's probably one of the most common things that I see. That and the implants not being parallel enough. You know, you have these attachments that are light years better than they used to be. They're fantastic. Yet, in my opinion, maybe they give people a little false sense of security on what they can and can't do. And they'll snap in. They'll also quickly snap out after a little while of function. Yeah. And so patients are very frustrated. They spent thousands and thousands of dollars and their teeth won't stay in and they can't eat what they want. So a lot of these cases, you're stuck because in a perfect world with enough space, you make a bar, you make them a very nice removable prosthesis that's rock solid. But when you don't have space, it's tricky. And that's where all these other techniques come in. You know, you've got the, I just forgot what Dentsply's.
The ISIS.
Conus. You have Conus where the idea is, you angle it, you correctly angle correct the implants and you still have a removable prosthesis. And that can work very well, but you also need space there too. So
yeah, I'm finding with time, angulation issues, there's been a lot of innovation nowadays, just within the last couple of years, that are focusing on correcting for poor angulation and making things possible. They have altered screw channels, things like Ken's talking about.
Maybe the greatest thing ever.
Yeah, but
screw channel.
I don't yet see a solution when there is not enough inner arch space. That's
would
a
you
tough
would you
one.
Say that on surgical guides that for a single, so the tooth most likely to be missing, root canal, crown, bridge, it's always the first molar.
Mm-hmm.
So if you got a second bicuspid and a second molar, I mean that's very different than what you said, putting four or six in an arch. Would you say that a surgical guide is far more important for multiple implants in an edentulous arch?
Yes.
Most likely, yeah. It depends on the operator, of course.
Are we talking any surgical guide or a CAD-CAM surgical guide versus a traditional surgical guide? Because if it's a full, the longer the edentulous span, I would argue, has to have a surgical guide. Doesn't matter what kind, but it has to be a surgical guide. That surgeon needs to know where that tooth is going to be if you're expecting a decent outcome. Now, it could be a duplicate of a denture with holes drilled in it. I mean, that's what we learned when we were in our residency. Me personally, I like doing it where it's done on the computer because it gives us the chance to kind of hash through some of those compromises before the surgery. But, and the one that I would argue doesn't have to have a surgical guide is where you've got a tooth and a tooth and one tooth missing right here. You just got to aim it right between the two teeth. It's not that hard.
What if someone said, my job is just to guess what my homies are thinking.
Sure.
And I know what they're screaming right now is saying, well, what kind of surgical guide? Because in dental town, yeah. There's more ways to make a surgical guide than there are pumpkin pie.
Right.
So if they're asking you, how would you make a surgical guide or what's the best surgical guide, what would you say?
So I've been through a lot. When I was in my residency, I did a lot of traditional ones where you've waxed up a tooth and then you've had something processed that might look a lot like a night guard with a tooth in it and you drill a hole in it. I haven't done that in a long time because me, the techie guy, wants to do CAD/CAM. In the CAD/CAM world, I've probably been through about 5 different systems. In residency, I tried Simplant, Facilitate, pretty much the same thing. Well, now Facilitate used to be what Astra bought as a copy of Simplant, but now that company has bought out Simplant, so they're the same thing. So Simplant is one.
Simplant was bought out by who?
By Dentsply Sirona now. Okay. So that's their thing.
Which is very, very common software.
And that was probably one of the first ones.
Oh, you
out
call it
there.
Dentsply Sirona or the Mafia? So Simplant is
so
now.
There's Simplant.
I'm going to make you an offer you can't refuse. Right. Okay,
there's
Simplant.
There. Then when I did my my research, I needed somebody who would work with me on the measurement side of things. So I tried a company called iDent. Okay. When I got into practice, I started using Anatomage and their software. It's called Invivo 5. Beautiful software, reasonable price.
Is that San Francisco, Animas?
So I want to say more like Nevada area, but don't quote me on that. But a lot of people use them. They have beautiful software, and their guides work well. Okay, they're still, you're looking at about $300 of what you're paying for that guide. What I am now moving towards, only because I'm very techie, and I like to get the cost of this guy down, is Blue Sky Bio has their software that's free to download called Blue Sky Plan. And what I have in my office is a 3D printer. And so I can take free software. I can pull in a cone beam CT scan. I can pull in an STL file of the patient's teeth and I can merge them together in this software. It's very robust software. It can do a whole lot. Down, you know, a single implant up into full arch cases, and all I pay Blue Sky to be able to get the file from them that I can then put into my 3D printer is I pay $15.
And when will this online CE course?
Right.
you know what's funny is these meeting attendance have been plummeting because I lectured a lot of these meetings. Yeah. A lot of times you'll be in there and they'll have an Excel spreadsheet of the attendance is plummeting, uh-huh. And they're just like, these millennials don't like to take CE. And, you know, it's like, no, these millennials.
Right.
Online.
And you know what the millennials also, it's so bizarre. If you look at your big screen TV and you hold your iPhone out, bring it in until you can't see your TV anymore. And they just lay there in bed and uh-huh. just lean this by their pillow and watch it that way.
Sure. Yeah.
And then they don't have to take any notes because all it's all there forever. So right. If you're like, what was that? You just go right back to the course and
sure.
flip through the PowerPoint. But that'd be an amazing... an amazing online C course on that.
That's the beauty of open source technology. I mean, it's only going to get better. It's going to get better and better for us to control. It's all about controlling the quality of the product that we're giving to our patients. And so us, that's what we're all about. It's our fault is the planning and kind of going overboard with that. But, you know, that's our passion. That's what we love to do. And it's only going to get better technology.
So I have that on Dental Town. You see that little search bar? I didn't show that when you were there yesterday, but anyway, mm-hmm. The Dental Town, they're all black servers, except the yellow one's Google.
Okay.
And that thing's $50,000. And then when you want to update it, you got to buy a new one for $50,000. But I just typed in, what implant is that? Mm-hmm. The name of your company. And these are all the threads that start with what implant is that. So I awesome. Just really want to thank you guys. See, here's the, here's the search bar. Yeah. But it is so, you guys do such an amazing service because, like, say, I'm in a dental town every day since 1998. And so, when anybody posts a picture or whatever, everybody always says, well, just go to what implant is that?
Thank you.
So that's, thank you very much. That's appreciate amazing. That.
We share that same passion that you do of how can I get information out there to people, not to make people rich, but to, you know, try to get the information in people's hands.
So now I'm just gonna keep on going with the controversial stuff. So yeah. She's so in dental school, 17% have no student loans because their dad was a dentist. Mm-hmm. And so then you got into thirds. About a third is about 100, a third is about 200, and a third it's over 300. And so they want to be a good dentist. They want to be a high tech. You've mentioned how you love CAD/CAM 3 or 4 times. Mm-hmm. I want to be a good dentist. And she's sitting there thinking, you know, am I a bad dentist if I just take an $18 Impergum impression and send it down to the lab in Mason? He makes me a $99 crown. Or do I need to buy a $150,000 CAD/CAM machine? Because I want to be like you guys when I grow up.
Right. You don't have to do this stuff. I mean, you have to treatment plan. I mean, that is my opinion. If you're not treatment planning these bigger cases, you're failing. If you treatment plan them right, and it doesn't matter if you do an intraoral scan of that case or you take a nice, good impression with PVS, okay? You can pull them, both of those you can pull off successfully. There's going to be pros and cons to both, but you can go either way. If you want to get into the techie stuff, there's the all-in way where you've bought your intraoral scanner, you've bought your 3D printer, you have your own cone beam CT scan, you invested everything, but you don't even have to do that. When I first got out into practice, I'm in a hospital setting. What that means is I don't have control over big purchases. It's taken me like 3 years just to convince them to get my intraoral impression unit. But for
which one did you go with?
I have the Trios, okay?
Trios, the 3Ms?
That's the 3 shape.
I have 3Ms.
He has 3Ms. You have 3Ms. That's the true definition.
True definition.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And those two. Out of, Denmark?
Yes.
Sounds about right.
Those two are very, very highly accurate from research, okay? So, but before I did that, I was doing PVS impressions, and when I wanted to get things digitized, if I wanted to do something digital, then I would rely on labs, because a lot of labs nowadays, they have lab scanners. And so, you know, for like these implant cases, for example, when I first started doing CAD/CAM surgical guides, I would digitize models to get it into that digital realm. Well, now I don't have to, because now I have an intraoral scanner, but you don't have to have the intraoral scanner. I wanted it because I'm a techie nerd. But if you want to be in digital dentistry, You probably already are without knowing it because your lab is using it more and more. But if you want to be more involved with digital dentistry, you can. I mean, digital dentures, you could do that with multiple companies. I use Avident, but...
Avident right here in Scottsdale.
Yeah, yeah. Wow. And so I've used Avident for my digital dentures. And when I first started with them, I sent them my impressions. After a while, we got a lab scanner. Now I use the Trios to scan my impressions.
You still use Avident?
Yeah. Wow. And I've been happy with them.
So now you got two courses to make.
Well, I know.
You got a digital dentist.
I got all sorts
of courses. And you got a surgical guide.
So, I mean, there's so many ways to get from point A to point B. My argument would only be, if you want to learn anything, learn how to treatment plan properly.
But here's where I see street smart and just not very smart. I was street smart. When I wanted to learn endo, I would walk across the street. I go over to Glenn Denning's endodontic office, Brad, and just ask if I could watch. You want to learn implants, you could just walk over and ask your periodontist or oral surgeons, or buy a textbook.
Yeah.
Like, yeah, you could buy Carl Misch's book on implantology for $200. And I would when I go to his lecture, people were asking questions. I mean, they were paying $3,000 for a weekend course, asking questions over in the first chapter of the book.
Sure.
And then I see the not so street smart with $350,000 student loans. Every time they want to learn anything, they got to get an airplane, fly across the country, drop $3,000 on a weekend course, and come back with a certificate.
Yeah.
It's like, dude, you got specialists. Like, so I'm going to ask you specifically.
Mm-hmm.
If some general dentist, some 25-year-old homie listening to you right now, just came by your office and had a question, would he be annoying you?
It happens all the time. I have tons of guys that come and hang out in my office. I do several study clubs. I try to meet every dentist in my neighborhood, which there's a lot in Mesa.
What's the population of Mesa? 500,000?
I don't know the number. I've heard it's one of, if not the biggest suburbs in the country, is what I've heard. Because, as you know, it's got pretty big boundaries. There's a lot of dentists there, a lot of population there. My philosophy is this. Look, I, as a restorative specialist, I'm there to help these guys' practice in whatever aspect that may be. I have some guys that love to treatment plan cases, and then we do them along the way together. I have some guys that say, you know what, I don't want this headache in my office because I realize I'm not making as much money as I thought I did. And it's just a liability that I don't want. And so, you know, I think today's prosthodontist is much different, or it should be, than it was 30 years ago, where, you know, dentistry is changing. I am all in the digital world as well, and what I found is it's made me a better dentist. But I think what can't go away is that the core principles are still there. You can't magically become a better dentist just because you're in the digital world. In fact, in my opinion, it's almost harder if you want to be a better dentist, because it forces you to prep better. It forces you to see those margins better. And if you already can't do that in the manual impression world, you're going to struggle in the digital world, unless you just don't care.
So basically what you just said is you're for oral health therapist.
I don't even know what that is.
that's the 9-month training program they're doing to make dentists.
Okay.
Low-income dentistry.
Yeah.
Not all my jokes are funny. Only about 10% of my jokes are funny.
My opinion on that one is that you become very biased as a specialist. You know, it's like I specialize in crowns, and so I feel like I make nice crowns. But I don't want to try to do every crown in town because I can't. But what I would like to do is do the complicated crowns in town and let the dentist do all the other ones. And there's, you know, very debatable what's complicated, what's not. But I think the best marriage of specialists to dentists would be that the dentists are taking on the bulk of it, but they're referring the complex. So if you have a dentist that never refers anything out...
Have you told this to any orthodontist yet?
No, I'm sure that people are yelling at me now.
All the specialties get that except orthodontists. I mean, the endodontist gets it. The oral surgeon gets it. The prosthodontist gets it. Everybody gets that.
Uh-huh.
But the orthodontist... You do one ortho case and you just like lose it.
But the thing is you get a lot of, like, I don't want to do single unit crowns. I mean, that's not what I was trained to do. I can do a nice job at it, and the patient's going to pay more for me to do that relatively simple crown. I want I'm in a small town. I want everybody in town to take the bulk of the pros, and I want everyone in town to send me the complicated stuff, so that I'm doing what I was trained to do and taking that burden off of them. And, I mean, I guess the driving force behind that is it's in the best interest of the patient.
Right.
If we can keep the cost lower by having the general dentist take care of the bulk of it and just send to the specialist the stuff that needs that additional attention.
But you're in a small town, La Crosse, right?
Yeah.
And I don't know what it is. I always beat this theme because... They don't know how to approach a specialist, but they can see a brochure and say, well, I'm going to take that course and pay $9.99 that they don't have, or $39.99 they don't have. In fact, the reason online CE is exploding, because when you fly your airplane to that that city, your cab fare on Uber to the resort would be less than the $12 course online.
Right.
But they're introverts. They're you know, dentists, they're engineers, scientists. Dentists are usually people who didn't have enough personality to become an accountant. And so they always think, well, I don't want to go knock on your door because I'm bugging you. What would you tell a young kid approaching a specialist?
If it would make things go the direction that I think is ideal, what I just described, I would absolutely love to sit down and teach them how to do a single unit better, if it means that they then are restoring the single units as good as I can, but then they send me the big case.
I know. And what I love about it is when you take a course on the other side of the country, and then later you have a problem, that instructor on the other side of America ain't going to be there.
Right.
But your drinking buddy alcoholic, you know, specialist up the street that you now is your friend, and you go to bars and watch football games with or whatever. I mean, he's your, now you got a friend.
Sure.
And you got a buddy who's going to cover your your screw-ups.
Right.
I'd rather have a friend when something went south.
Yeah.
Than, and plus it's just cheaper. I mean, it's faster, easier, lower cost, cheaper.
Amen.
Yeah, amen. So now I'm going to say, you guys are so sweet to come over here and give me an hour, and we're already in over an hour, but I still got more questions. Do you mind going into some overtime?
Yeah, got nowhere to be.
Because I know what they're thinking. Another very stressful thing for them, and it gets asked all the time. You know, every graduating class since Fred Flintstone complains that their dental school didn't teach them everything. Mm-hmm. And it's just the nature of the game. I mean,
it's impossible.
I know. They take 100 kids off the street, and 4 years later turn them legally licensed to pull teeth and do root canals. The last thing I'd ever want to be is a dean, and I think that dental schools do a phenomenal job.
I had a mentor in dental school that told me, in all reality, we teach you just enough not to kill somebody.
Yeah.
When you get out of dental school.
Yeah. So. And it's a life. I mean, dental school never ends. And everyone who's successful in the 30 year of my observation is continue to take 100 hours of CE a year their whole life. I mean, everything just keeps changing all day long. But they got some specific decisions. I want to learn occlusion. I want to learn TMD. It looks like there's two camps. There's this neuromuscular camp, mm-hmm. and there's a CR camp. So you have, you know, I need to go right or left. What would you say about it? And the other thing I got to ask you, I assume if we had a whole table of endodontists, there wouldn't be very many passionate arguments over something that they couldn't agree on. Mm-hmm. If I sat down 100 if this whole table was pediatric dentist, there wouldn't be any passionate yelling or screaming or whatever. If I sat down 25 guys in TMD, it'd be no different than religion. You have Hindus and Buddhists and Catholics,
right.
and it's crazy. So is that because it's just more complex, or is it because it's just more not based on science? Why is it so controversial? And why on the message boards do we have to tell? I mean, we spend more time editing out profanity discussing TMD, and we never have to do that in pediatric dentistry.
Right.
So why is it so controversial? Why is it so crazy?
That's a great question. You know, a couple thoughts that come to my mind are, personalities. I think there's a certain percentage of folks that want to make a name for themselves, possibly. You know, you got to say something different. You can't say the same stuff over and over, and nobody really recognizes you. I don't know if that has an aspect of it, but we were obviously trained a specific way. And
I'd say most prosthodontists probably are CR, not neuromuscular.
I don't probably have a good answer for that, other than there's probably more science, biological-minded people than others, and so maybe they feel it needs to be more specific than a CR-type solution. I don't really know.
To be honest, I mean, I was trained how to find somebody's centric relation position, when to worry about it, when not to, and just some other basics, you know, get bilateral, equal contacts, try to shoot for some kind of favorable disclusion, canine guidance, anterior coupling, things like that. To me, they feel like such basic things that can be applied to almost all dental situations when it comes to occlusion, which includes joint problems. I mean, but then, so to me, it just seems simple. Like, there's no debate. Like, why not just do it this way?
As prosthodontists, are you redoing a lot of cases because they open the bite and cause TMJ and all this, and you're changing the bite and the occlusion and solving their TMJ?
No.
I haven't seen much of that. No.
But I don't see a ton of rehabs anymore. You know, it seems like it's I don't know if it's a lost art. That's probably not accurate, but The issues that I typically see deal with implant complications, whether it's a space issue, poor placement.
What
percent of your
some.
Cases are implant related?
75%.
Okay, three
Pretty
out
high.
Of four.
Maybe more 50%.
So again, podcasters are young. One of their first prosthodontic questions is, when can I use a Silas Premier triple tray and send it to the lab? When do I have to switch to full arch impressions? And do I ever have to mount it on a semi-adjusted articulator? Can you answer that? take a shot at that.
When we're talking single restorations with a full complement of teeth, I've done a ton of triple trays. I mean, I've been practicing 5-6 years in a little different atmosphere than my partner here, but done well with correct principles, they can work just fine. Now, when you're talking a terminal tooth, nothing behind it, you only capture one tooth in front of it, may get a little dicey as far as accuracy goes. And there's obviously different kinds of triple trays and so forth.
So for a second molar then, how many teeth do you need to pick up on that triple tray?
I'm going to go as far as I can. I'd love to go to the canine. Yeah. And if it's a really kind of screwy occlusion, then I may go full arch impression. But that's the other beauty that I see in digital dentistry, is that it's so much more accurate from a bite standpoint, where I can capture that whole quadrant. You could do the whole arch probably even faster than you could with an impression and get that accuracy. But
what I liked the most about going to CERAC was not anything the digital. It was I think the fastest ways to be a better dentist is to go from naked eye to loops.
Mm-hmm.
First time I scanned one of my impressions and I saw it 40 times bigger, yes. I thought Stevie Wonder cut the prep. And I was like, whoa. And I remember talking to one of my friends, and he was telling me, he says, you know what? And it goes even further than that. He goes, when you take those end cutting burrs, he goes, when you see that little flash, if you could see that 100 times better, that'd be like another uh-huh. divot. And then endodontists all tell me that the number one cause of a failed root canal is you missed a canal. You know, you just yep. missed a bunch. And sure. so when they mount a microscope. So magnification probably has more to do with faster, cheaper quality yeah. than mm-hmm. anything else. Because at the end of the day, we're a monkey working with our hands.
Sure, absolutely.
And if that monkey can see 40 times bigger, his hands are going to do a lot better job.
Yeah. yeah. As far as articulation and so forth, just probably by nature, the majority of what I do is on articulator, mainly because there's lots of planning that we need to do and so forth.
And but, what's your articulator?
I use a Stratus, but I also have a Danar and a Hanau in my lab as well. But the bulk of the heavy lifting is done with a Stratus in my office.
And how much is a Stratus articulator?
I think they have three different kinds. This is Ivoclar's product, mm-hmm. and they have three different articulators. They have a basic one, a semi-adjustable, and a fully adjustable.
Stratus articulator has three types. It has
yep.
a 100,
basically, 200, I, yeah, the 100, 200, 300.
100, 200, 300.
That's not the dollar amount. That's the name of it.
Yeah, that's not the
yeah I wish that was a dollar amount.
Well,
yeah.
What's a dollar amount?
I think that the basic one is around like $800 probably. And then maybe $1,000, maybe $12, if I had to guess.
Yeah.
$800, $1,000, $12.
Right.
Yeah, somewhere in that.
And that would be another great course, especially for you. When to use an articulator, because it is an extremely
sure.
You know, 29 years of being a dentist and owning Dental Town from 98 to 2016. Uh-huh. I know the questions.
Right. Oh, I'm sure.
I mean, if you lecture 1,000 times and you're 4 hours a day on this for, mm-hmm. for two right. decades, at 54, I can tell you what the 25-year-olds sure. are thinking.
And, I mean, I said earlier, I'm an anal prosthodontist. I use a full arch every time on an articulator every time.
Even for a single crown?
I do. Now, I would not sit down and argue somebody that my way is right and yours is wrong. It's just what I do.
Okay, so tell more about an articulator. So you mount these cases on an articulator?
The lab does. One of the reasons I like the Stratus.
Do you take a bite with the articulator?
So I full arch, upper, lower, and a bite. That goes off to the lab. Now, obviously, now I'm going digital.
Do you
take
the bite with the ear? Do you face mode transfer to the articulator?
I will do it on the complex cases. This is my answer to your question. When do you do a triple tray versus this? The more information you capture and provide to the lab, the fewer adjustments you're going to have chair side. And so if you're doing a full case, a full rehab, if you do a face bow, it's just more information that the lab has, which means if it was done well, if it's accurate, you should have less adjustments chair side. If I mean, there you can go nuts. I mean, and there are people out there that, and I'm not saying they're nuts. I'm saying you can gather some very specific information. Most face bows that people are doing, they're going off of an average position of where the joint is. Some people will find exactly where the joint is and record that position. You know, I mean, there's you can really go hog wild with gathering information. And my opinion is the more information you provide the lab, the fewer adjustments you're going to have. And
I think what lab do you use?
I've been using one out of Idaho called Precision.
Called Precision out of
Precision
Idaho?
Dental Arts, yeah.
I know a girl that moved here from Idaho, and she left because she's tired of saying Idaho. Precision in Idaho.
Yeah.
And what lab are you using?
I use a lab called Centric Stop Lab here in Mesa.
I've heard of Centric Stop.
Mm-hmm. It's small. They don't advertise.
They just did. They just did.
The owner does a lot of the work personally.
Yeah, I'm sure you'll each get a basket of cookies.
Yeah, right.
Two labs. So same question. When it's good because they're when do they need to take a face bow transfer and mount it to a Stratus articulator from Ivoclair 100, 200, 300, costing 800, 1,000, or 1,200?
I think the basic concept there is, look, if we're dealing with aesthetics, that we're changing aesthetics, if we're dealing with changing the jaw position, we're changing occlusion and all those types of things, we need to be accurate with the movement of the jaw and the joint. And that's where the face bow
And that's
comes
what
in.
A face bow is doing, is it's just relating things to the joint.
I think there's a good compromise there, too. I mean, are you going to take somebody who doesn't believe in that philosophy and they're going to all of a sudden start using a face bow? No, because face bow is a pain in the butt. But there's compromises now.
I think if it's a pain in the butt, you're using it at the wrong end. It should be a pain in the jaw.
Yes, pain in the jaw.
Are you using it correctly?
But then you have like the Coise face bow facial analyzer, which I think is a pretty good middle ground. I use that a lot in my practice, specifically for dentures, because it's very simple.
I know.
But it's still based on the same principles.
Yeah. Using averages. Yeah, it's getting you close.
I know. I told John.
But would I use that on a full arch case? No, I wouldn't. I'm going to use an adjustable face bow. So I think you have to use some...
talk about that John Coise deal that because that is very, very popular and growing in popularity.
Sure, absolutely.
So can you spend a few minutes on that?
It's very simple to use. It's basically like a Fox plane with a little plastic bite fork on it that records your midline and the maxillary occlusion. It's also got the long middle pin that you can find the middle of their face very quickly and easily. And so it adapts well to the Stratus articulator. I think it's even got things for other brands as well, right, where you can mount that. So it's very quick and easy, but it's still giving you that level of accuracy that you wouldn't have otherwise.
I have many friends that just love that. And told John...
It works well.
I told John he should do an online CE course and it explode that.
Mm-hmm.
And I also got a trick on that thing.
What's that?
Well, he's Greek, so if you spray it with Windex before, it'll... did you see my big fat Greek wedding?
The first one or the second one?
remember the old Greek guy with the Windex?
Oh, spray? That's right. It fixes everything.
Yeah, it fixes everything. Yeah, he's even spraying on his skin.
It's been a long time.
I love that joke. I want to talk about something that really grinds my gears. I see a lot of, whether they be, I'm sure you've seen lawsuits or you know, disaster cases and things that went totally wrong. Because there was a missing tooth, and to do the case, they had to do a sinus lift and bone graft and all this shit, and it all went south. And there were two virgin teeth right next to that tooth. There was a second bicuspid and a second molar. Yeah. And I always look at this damn dentist who thinks the teeth are sacred, but you could throw a nuclear bomb in the sinus because that's not his area. And then I talk to my ENT people at Lifetime, and they're like, man, sometimes we scope up there, and there's an implant in the sinus, and there's white yeast infection everywhere, and why don't you, dentists, stay on your damn teeth and stay out of my goddamn sinus? And I'm just sitting here thinking, like, If you were an ear, nose, and throat, would you really have no problem with sticking cow bone and a paperclip up in a sinus? But since you're a, so the question is specifically this. Do you think that because you're a dentist, that you worship at the altar of enamel, and enamel is sacred, but it's immoral and you'll go to hell if you destroy enamel, but no problem destroying sinus and packing it with weird stuff? Because sometimes I look at a case that went so terribly wrong and I thought, damn, you, that could have been a 3-unit bridge in 2 weeks. What is wrong with our profession when there's militant nut jobs saying that you cannot ever do a 3-unit bridge because if you file down enamel, you shouldn't even have a license to be a dentist?
I destroyed plenty of enamel. Let's just say that on the record. You know, I think that you have to have discretion there. I don't pretend to be an expert in the sinus, or I don't do any surgery in my practice. Right. I work with a periodontist in my office, which is fantastic. So I leave those decisions up to him, and he's very good at what he does.
But in saying that, when's the last time you did a 3-unit bridge?
I've done a few. I don't do it a ton, to be honest. But you know, there's reasons for that. It doesn't mean I don't, you know, I've done plenty, but,
so you still do 3-unit bridges?
I do.
You still do 3-unit bridges?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. If it's a young person and there's nothing wrong with those two teeth, I'll be honest, I'm going to think implant first. No question about it.
Because you went to the Church of Dentistry?
Probably.
And not the Church of Rhinology?
Probably.
I think the problem comes when people want to associate a treatment with a situation. You know, oh, you have a missing tooth? Implant. Conversation's over. Because, you know, obviously that's an extreme when you see a problem go wrong because of grafting in the sinus, because there's plenty of cases where that went fine. But my thought is the multidisciplinary approach. I talk to the patient, I say, these are your options. Which one are you hoping for? They say, well, you know, I want it quick, so let's do the bridge. Okay, let's do the bridge. Or they say, no, I don't want to touch the other teeth, because that's their decision, not mine. And they say, I don't want to. Can we explore the implant? I'm not then saying, yep, you're a candidate. I'm saying, well, let's get you now talking to the oral surgeon, and they'll tell you if you're a candidate for the implant. Sometimes the surgeon looks at the case and says, I don't know if I can pull this off successfully. Maybe we should do the bridge. And we've seen anterior implants go horribly wrong. And in hindsight, you're going, well, this would have been a lot easier if we just did a bridge.
Do you know Jason Howell?
Yeah, very well.
Do you know his rhinologist friend?
No.
You, me, and Jason got to go have lunch with his rhinologist friend. I mean, he's got tons of disaster.
Is that right?
Implant cases in the sinus.
Wow.
Where he's always whining to Jason, like, why are they doing this to my sinuses? And so you want to do that someday?
Yeah, that'd be fun.
Yeah, set that up, because I think that the problem with Dental Town is they're all from one religion.
Uh-huh.
And they need to, hey, did you know there's doctors in other parts of the head? There's rhinologists, there's ear, nose, and throat.
Yeah.
And you should listen to what you're doing from rhinologists who look into implants and sinuses sometimes and think, what the hell's going on? Okay, another big controversy.
Mm-hmm.
When we were little, to be a successful implantologist, the implant had to be at least a mile long. It had to be the longest implant in the world.
I know where you're going with
that. You could go around them 100 times. Now some guys, mainly from Britain, uh-huh, are posting these short fat implants that are only like 8 millimeters long, so they're avoiding sinuses.
Right. Straumann just came out with like four or six millimeter.
Some people are saying, well, all the stress transferred to the bones in the first 3 or 4 millimeters. But there's some people on Dental Town that post after all those short fat cases. I like the short fat implant because I'm short and fat, so I just like to support anything short and fat. long and narrow and tall like you, I just hate to begin with. So what's your thoughts on short and fat implants?
That's a great question.
I think that, so the way I would start the discussion is, you get a lot of people that have done research on these short implants, and they do a bunch of cases and they say, well, look what I did, and it was successful, so that means it should always be successful. But then you look at many instances where long implants weren't successful for one reason or another. My surgeons don't like going over 11.5 millimeters because they think the bone will necrose at those deeper parts where they can't irrigate. So, I mean, you get a lot of opinions out there. I personally think all of them have the potential to work. That's my opinion. They all have the potential to work.
I think it'd be easy to answer that if everything was comparing apples to apples, right?
Right.
I mean, it's a human being. There's a million different factors there. I'm not opposed to a short, fat implant. We use the 5.5 Nobel conical, 8 millimeters, 10 millimeters for first, second molars a lot. And if it's a single tooth and they've got a full complement of teeth and they've got all the normal things there, they've got disclusion, they've got anterior guidance, all those types of things, you're probably going to be successful unless you're out in the weeds with some implant that's maybe doesn't have a track record or something like that. But
and you got to look at everything. I mean, you're not going to go in the maxillary posterior on somebody who chews and spits out anything that goes in their mouth and stick these tiny little implants and not be surprised if it doesn't go well. But you get somebody who shows no signs of wear, they have canine disclusion, and you're doing a single implant in the mandibular anterior, whatever, an area. There's so many ways you can look at the situation, take everything into account, and try to figure out what's best.
Okay, you guys have been so adorable and sweet. I mean, you guys have stayed an hour and a half, so I'm not going to use you more. I'm just going to ask you one final question.
Okay.
Probably 20% of those guys are junior, senior in dental school. The other 80% are probably just graduated to 30. Right now, they're trying to master a single unit crown on a first molar. Being a prosthodontist, what do you think, give them one thing that you've observed being a prosthodontist that could help them do a single unit crown? What is the most common mistake? What do you think, what grinds your gears? What do you sometimes think, if those general dentists, when they're just doing a molar, a first molar, I wish they would...
For me, two things that I see is prep design, meaning that they're often over-prepped, over-tapered. But probably the biggest pet peeve that I have are just cheap crowns. Just cheap, junky, ugly-looking crowns. And whether they're going to China, who knows? Whether they're just the cheapest. I see a big trend towards these non-precious metals, things like that. Gingiva looks
I'm really not thinking junky. China. I'm thinking Apache Junction.
Okay. You'll have to let me know what labs are out there.
Yeah.
But no, and their gingiva is ugly. It's not healthy, whatever the case may be. And so that's kind of my biggest pet peeve is that, as well as I do, it's economics in their own mind. I got to find the cheapest crown that I possibly can. And I don't think that's fair to the patient. If you have to do that and you have to...
Well, what do you think the lab bill... What kind of value... Because you see the implants, you see expensive... Value, you see low cost. What price range do you think you pay to get junk, and what price range do you think you're paying to get more value?
That's a good question.
$100 100 tends to be the cheap crowns.
Yeah, probably. I've seen them even less than that. I've worked in certain places where they were using crowns that were less than that, and I don't care who you are. Can you get a good quality crown for less than $100? Probably not. So, that's a tough decision. But it all depends on, who are you using. One of the reasons I use the lab that I do is because they're a small mom and pop that has good principles and they use good quality materials and they physically do their work themselves for me. And so they know what I expect and they know I'm going to be hard on them if they don't produce that.
So you're in Mesa. If they come in from Apache Junction to use like a $80 crown... And they drive in from Gilbert or Scottsdale, use a $200 crown?
No, it's all the same for everybody.
Yeah. Okay.
I'd say my answer to the question is that people are paying you a lot for these crowns. And I feel that dentists need to take on the responsibility to deliver what the patient is expecting. And so... and don't be scared to tell the patient that this isn't right, we need to do something to make it right. Because every patient that I've explained to them, you know, hey, this, there's a small area where there's an open contact, open margin, something's just a little off, do you want me to send it back to the lab and get that corrected? Almost every time they're like, well, yeah, if we can do that, let's do that. I'm not saying that it's making you more money, but if you want to provide great service, own it. And in time, you're going to get it better and better until the point that you're not having to send stuff back. But when you're new, fresh out of school, you're not doing perfect crowns. You weren't trained well enough in school to do perfect crowns. And so when you get out, you try your darndest to make a perfect crown, but when it's not perfect, tell the patient why it's not perfect and what you're going to do about it. And they're, I would guess that you're going to gain respect.
We have the best treat. Come here, Taylor. This is the best podcast ever. Come here and end the show. Come here, Taylor.
So what do you know about teeth?
So tell him that. So now Grandpa's going to take Taylor to the Arizona Grand Fair. So tell him this is the end of the show. Can you say that? So this is what God gives you as a reward for not killing all four of your boys.
There you go.
This is, nice. That's the definition of a granddaughter. Yes. There was only one reason I didn't shoot all four of my boys, and her name is Sarah. Thank you so much.
Thank you, it's a pleasure.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, guys. Say that's all, folks.
Thumbs up.
She's shy like her grandpa.